what I learned is that if a student of knowledge does two things, he'll benefit a lot.
Okay.
The first thing I say is الصفات التي ينبغي أن يتحلى بها طالب العلم. Characteristics that a student of knowledge must and should adorn himself with. And these are like the following. Number one, he has to be sincere.
Hmm.
If you're embarking on this path of seeking knowledge, you have to be very sincere. You can't have, you know, another motive, another thought in your mind. This should be for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Number two, as-sidqu fi al-talab. You have to be truthful in seeking knowledge. And the difference between sincerity and truthfulness is that sincerity, it means you're doing it for Allah alone.
Okay, yeah.
And truthfulness means that you're, whilst you're seeking knowledge, you're not associating knowledge with anything else.
You're focusing on it alone.
Wholeheartedly.
Mm.
And I say you spend three things on knowledge. You spend your money.
Yeah.
You spend your nafs. You see, you know, you spend your time on it. If you give those three to it, all of it, it will give you something in return.
And those three things are your life, basically.
Basically, yeah. The third thing is that the person has al-amalu bil-ilm. Whatever has been Allah gave you, the small knowledge that you've taken, implement it. Make sure that you implement it. And I always give this example, which is if a mother's feeding a child and she puts food in the child's mouth, she won't put more food in his mouth unless he swallows what was already was already put in his mouth. So swallow it first, and then, in other words, digest that, take that in. Same is with when it comes to knowledge. Allah will only give you what you've taken in, what you've digested, what you've implemented in your life. The fourth one is the person has himma ali, high aspiration. See, knowledge, you need to be a person who has high aspiration. And you have to enjoy that pain that comes with it. Enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
High aspiration. Some people, they might say the sky is the limit. I say, no, the sky isn't even the limit. I've given this example quite a lot of times, and that is the reason why they call the lion the king of the jungle is because a lion doesn't eat dead corpse. A lion loves to hunt.
It's beneath him to eat.
That's for hyenas, and you know, he's got a title called the king of the jungle. So he has to exert effort and hard work. That's what a lion is, right?
Yeah.
So if you want to be high, you have to exert, you know, have to believe that this is not something that you could just, high aspiration. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he tell us? He said, إِذَا سَأَلْتُمُ اللَّهَ الْجَنَّةِ, if you're going to ask Allah for Jannah, فَسَأَلُوهُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ, ask Jannah to الْفِرْدَوْسِ. Don't just say, oh Allah, I want Jannah, any part in Jannah is enough for me. فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازَ, anyone who's protected from the hellfire and he's been put in Jannah, then they found success. As long as I get my leg into Jannah, that's all I want. Don't say that. You're a Muslim. You're a mu'min, inshallah. Have high aspirations. Say, oh Allah, I want Jannah to Firdaus. The Prophet's teaching his companions that. The next characteristics that a person should adorn himself with is عدم الاستعجال. Don't be hasty. See, knowledge doesn't come all in once. Don't be hasty. Take time. This is like knowledge that was written for like 1,000 something years. You can't take it all in once. ولذلك the Salaf, they said, من أخذ العلم جملة, anyone who tries to take knowledge all at once, فاتته جملة, all of it will go at once. But the way you can attain knowledge is بالأيام والليالي. Days and nights. So it's time it needs from you. Don't try to do all at once. And last but not least, ملازمة العلماء. To be with the people of knowledge. And even if you can't get the scholars, at least be with those who are higher than you. Those who've, you know, preceded you in knowledge, who preceded you in righteousness, be in their company, because they're going to put you up. They're going to encourage you. They're going to advise you, and they're going to push you forward. So you're going to scrape off, you know, their good habits are going to, it's going to show on you, and you're going to get from it. You'll learn how to organize your time. You're going to learn how to carry yourself, and etc. Those are the characteristics that I believe when you're seeking knowledge and you're embarking on this path, you need to have al-ikhlas, and the second one, sidqu fit talab, and the third one is al-amalu bil-ilm. And the fifth, the fourth was himma aliyah, and the fifth was adam al-istijal, and the sixth one was mulazamatul ulama. those are the that's the first thing I believe. If you want to learn and you want to benefit from your time going to seek knowledge, to sit with the scholars, to go to another country, those are the six things that you need to adorn yourself with. That's what you need to come with from your country, with that mindset that this is what you're gonna, inshallah ta'ala, you're gonna do.
Beautiful advice.
Now the second point is a methodology, and this is where a lot of people struggle. I've come with all of these characters. I'm sincere. I'm truthful. I'm with the scholars.
Yeah.
But I don't know what to study. What should I do? How should I do it? So the methodology is the second point. And here, the concept of what to study, manhajiyatul amaliya fi dhabt al-ilm, the methodology of how to be precise in knowledge, how to really understand knowledge, is five. I'll break it into two.
Okay.
The first one is marahil, stages that you need to go through. If you miss one stage, or if you jump a stage, or if you bring two stages into one, it will show in your ability of comprehension. And that is, number one, you have to go through the marhala to ta'sis. You're grounding yourself first. Learn the ground, learn the foundations first. Mm-hmm. Don't talk about what's not your level. Stay in your lane, as they say. Ta'sis, ground yourself. Here at that level, you're just going to learn everything from the foundation. I'll give you an example. When you come to seek knowledge, wallahi, this is a statement my father said to me, and I remember it. He said to me that when you're seeking knowledge, you're like a house that has holes inside it. In order for the floor to be built, first of all, they have to what? They have to make sure that those holes are filled.
Mm-hmm.
That's the foundation. So it won't show. Marhalatu ta'sis won't show. It won't come to the surface yet.
Mm.
So if you're expecting to be a scholar and teach at that moment, or be a alim, or people refer back to you, then nothing's seen on you. There's nothing there. You haven't got anything yet. It's just when you pass those that level, then things start emerging onto the surface. So marhalatu ta'sis. The second marhala that the student goes through is called marhalatu tadlil. Marhalatu tadlil is where the person now asks evidences, looks for evidences, tries to find out what the evidences are. You know, he's got the foundations. Now it's more like, what's the evidence? Because he can ask about evidence. He can find out about evidence. The third one is the stage where it's called ilmul muqaran. Marhalatu ilmul muqaran. He compares ideas and views. He's able to compare things. He can say, look, this view holds this. This is their evidence.
Mm-hmm.
This group, these group of scholars, they say this, and this is their evidence. Okay. They can compare views.
He's at that level now.
He's at that level. But he still can't strengthen one opinion from the other. He can compare opinions. Okay, these are the differences between the opinions. The fourth level is where it starts to become marhalatu tahrir. He does tahrir of the mas'ala. He says, this opinion is stronger than this opinion, and this is stronger than this opinion.
Tarjih.
Yeah, he strengthens one opinion from the other. And the fifth and last stage is when the student actually, he does marhalatu takhassus. He specializes now. This is my field of expertise. I'm good at this. But guess what? This is the problem I found.
Mm-hmm.
Is that marhalatu takhassus, where you specialize, is the stage where many people start to do that at an early stage.
Yeah, I see.
At the beginning, as in seeking knowledge, you have to try to learn all the sciences. And then after that, when you've studied all of the sciences, Allah is not going to make all the sciences the same. They don't all feel the same.
Sure.
There is going to be one science that sticks out for you, a science that you appreciate, a science that, you know, a lot of the times the way to appreciate science is when it's more applicable in your life.
Mm.
That's how you feel that science is for you. A lot of the times.
Okay.
You take that science and you go forward in that science and you specialize in it. But that doesn't mean you're ignorant about all the other sciences. Those five levels are the tadarruj fi talab, the gradual stages of learning. You see?
Yeah.
Another point that I wanted to mention as a side point is that when it comes to these issues that are being looked at in issues of fiqh and stuff like that, and I'm an ilm of the knowledge of the deen, what I found when I went to my scholars and, you know, these halaqat that I went to, the shuyukh that I saw, I realized there are four levels that if a person has conversations between scholars, private gatherings that you go to, ulama, in their lectures, you can really enjoy it.
Mm.
And it even opens the path of literally reading a book for hours on end, and you literally enjoy it, is when these four things are in place.
Okay.
Number one is if you have what is known as tasawwurul mas'alati, tasawwuran sahihan. You have a perception of this issue. I found over the years, because we're students, I remember sometimes a sheikh would go for a book with us, and then when the teacher goes, amongst ourselves, the students will start having discussions over it, and you know, and then whatever we didn't understand would come to the sheikh and we ask him later. But what I realized is, and one of the things that my sheikh used to point out was, which is, we're arguing, but guess what? We're not even talking about the same thing. Like if we sat down and said, "What do you mean by that?"
Yeah, okay, different perceptions.
Note it down. And what do you mean by that? Okay, I'm talking about the same thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? A lot of khilafs will go out of the window.
Yeah.
So the concept of perception of what you're talking about and what you're going to give a ruling to, first of all, is important. The scholars, they say, "Al-hukmu ala shay' faru'un an tasawwuri." To place a ruling on something, first of all, perceive it correctly. Then the second comes, which is ma'rifatul hukmi, which is to know the ruling. After I've perceived this issue, what is the ruling for it? And of course, the rulings are going to be one of five: halal, permissibility, haram, mubah, makruh, masnoon. You know, those five levels. The third stage, I say, is ma'rifatul jawami'i wal fawariq, that you know the differences between you can see the differences between different issues. Like, for example, if we're talking about an issue and you're talking about another issue, we have to know that there are similarities in these issues and there are differences as well. If there comes a difference, it could change the whole ruling. Some people are like, "Oh, but it's similar." But if it's similar, it's a different discussion. Is it the same? No. Then of course, we're going to have to put it aside for now. And the fourth is ma'rifatu maratibi al-masail, knowing the levels of all the issues, which is the strongest, which is the lowest, which is then high, then hakada. I believed when I got those four, I benefited from reading, benefiting from the ulama, going to the halaqat, reading books, having discussions with people.
Amazing advice. Barakallah.